What's so impressive about Mr. Coley's case was not only was he convicted based on eyewitness evidence, but it was two eyewitnesses. One of the eyewitnesses looked out the window from a second-story apartment into a dark parking lot. The second eyewitness was someone who tied him to a particular point in time based on facts that they remembered from the event. What's typical and very interesting about Mr. Coley's case is that he was exonerated based on DNA evidence, and it was DNA evidence that surfaced decades after the homicide had actually occurred. But he was convicted based on eyewitness evidence. And it's very common that these overturned cases are cases where the initial conviction turned on eyewitness evidence. Eyewitness evidence is highly flawed, and it's a leading cause of erroneous convictions. Of course, we are very often reliable eyewitnesses, but there are many circumstances, and they are in fact predictable circumstances, when eyewitnesses are going to be flawed. That's what we study as cognitive scientists, to figure out when are eyewitnesses more likely to be correct, when are they more likely to be incorrect. And we tie it down to particular circumstances more than just a general statement of eyewitnesses are always right or they're always wrong. Here at Claremont Graduate University, we tend to do research on processes that actually have real-world implications. And so I study memory, but I study eyewitness memory. I'm looking to identify factors that relate to the accuracy of eyewitness memory. How are eyewitnesses tested? How are lineups constructed? How is information gathered by police officers and so forth? And what can police officers do to make sure that they get more diagnostic information from eyewitnesses? The training that we offer in the cognitive psychology program here at Claremont Graduate University prepares students to do a range of different things. In our program, they end up with a very strong background in methodology and statistics, and a very strong background in content area, and throughout their whole course of study, they're doing research. About a third of our students actually go into academic jobs, and the other two-thirds have sought all along jobs, for example, doing research in policy centers. And another area where cognitive psychologists are employed at a high rate in very good jobs is in the technology industry, doing what's called user experience, or UX. So they've got, you can see, a range of options that are pretty exciting: academic job, policy related jobs, and user experience in the technology field.